395, if you would, 395. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. Let's all stand together as we sing. In my heart there rings a melody. On that verse together. I have a song that Jesus gave me. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary. But within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless amen glory. A song with glorious harmony when the chords of heaven ring. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love.
All right, good singing this morning. Good to see everybody in church today. You made it through our little bit of snow. And how many of you like to see snow before Christmas?
Amen.
Do you? How many hope it goes away after Christmas? And yeah, that's us, all right? Get about 3 weeks of winter and we're done. That'd be all right. But it doesn't quite work that way, though, all right? But I'm glad you made it through and you're here this morning. Looking forward to what the Lord has for us today. Thanks for being in church this morning. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for another Lord's Day that you've given to us. And Father, thank you for each one who's made their way here. We do lift up those this morning who are unable to be with us, Lord. They're not feeling well, and I pray that you would put your healing hand upon them. Some are here and are not feeling well, and I pray that, again, you would strengthen them. And Lord, make this service exactly what you know that we need it to be. And Lord, we want to honor you, and we want to praise you, and we want to give worship to you. And so, Lord, we pray that you'll hear the songs we sing, that we'll sing with grace in our heart unto you. And that, Lord, our focus and our attention will be on you for these next hour or so that we spend together. May you use the music and our fellowship and honor the preaching of your word today. May you lift up Christ, and as he's lifted up, draw all of us closer to him because we were in church this morning. And I pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shining afar through ladders dim, giving a light for those who long have gone, and guiding the white men on the way unto the place where Jesus lay. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn. Oh, give us thy light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star, the hope of light, guiding the pilgrim through the night, over the mountain till the break of dawn, and into the light of perfect day, it'll give out a lovely way. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn. Oh, give us a light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star, the hope is bright.
beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn. You'll give us the light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn. Oh, give us the light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
All right, very good. Let's go to 133. I'm sorry. 133. Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain. 133. On that first together. Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain. And the mountains in reply echo back their joyous strains.
Listen carefully now, some announcements, and got a great night tonight planned. 5:45, the children will be putting on their Christmas program, and they practiced very, very hard yesterday for several hours, and they're looking forward to tonight, 5:45, all right? And we'll start sharp at 5:45, so be on time. It help the kids if it's people aren't coming in late and it's distracting to them. Parents, make sure your children are here whatever time they're supposed to be here. I'm sure it's not 5:45, okay? And I know that much. And but get them here early and ready to go, and we'll have a great time. We'll go right into the service right after the play, and just a few minutes in between there, and we'll have a great, great time together this evening, and I know you'll look forward to that. And then remember, next Sunday night will be 6 o'clock p.m. Next Sunday night, 6 o'clock, the choir will be doing The Hope of Christmas. There's a great Reader's Theater type thing, a dramatization with it that is a great message, and you're going to enjoy it. That's going to be a great time. So plan this tonight, 5:45, next Sunday night, 6 o'clock for the adult choir, and for that presentation. It's going to be great. All right? Then Also remember the Christmas banquet tomorrow night out of Dear Dutchman. Doors open 6:30, and they start serving at 7, all right? So we look forward to a great time together there tomorrow night. And regular schedule as far as through the week, Wednesday night for our midweek service right here at 7, and the children's clubs that meet during that time as well. Next Saturday morning, we're going to be doing some Christmas caroling. Nursing home we want to go to, and carol there, and then another special stop we're going to make. And so come on out and be part of that, would you? Be a blessing to folks next Saturday morning. 10 o'clock we'll leave, so get here a little bit earlier. We'll meet out in the fellowship hall and then leave from there, but it's 10 to noon. We'll be back by usually 11:30, 11:45, something like that. And it's a great, great time together. I hope you'll be a part of that. Also, I want to announce Paula Ross. As some of you know, Paula's been in the hospital with, she had some surgery back in July that just various problems and such. She's been in the hospital, I think, 5 months for the most part, and coming up on 6. And so pray for her, but the ladies have gotten a gift bag over here. Thelma has it, and it's going to be in the back, and she'll be in the back after the service. But just any small little gift you'd like to get her, just let her know you're thinking about her, praying for her. You can bring that in tonight. How long are you going to have it back there? Next week too? The 18th? Okay. So you can be thinking about that. And Paula did, when I talked to her this week, she wanted one favor. She said, of course, Ronnie, her husband, and her dad are at home and been fending for themselves for the most part. And she said he can make all the side dishes for Christmas, but he can't make the turkey. They have a turkey. They have one to make, but they need someone who might be willing to cook the turkey for him and then take it there on, like, Christmas Eve so that they could have it for Christmas Day. Emma? You're good for that? Great. Thank you so much. That's wonderful. And if you see me, I'll make sure that we get in touch with them and we'll get that worked out. Thank you so much. That's wonderful. All right. Okay. I think that's all I've got right now. Let's take a moment and welcome our visitors that are with us today. We're always glad when folks visit with us in the service, and we have some folks visiting with us this morning. We just want to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. If you're visiting today, you don't have to stand up, but if you put your hand up, we can recognize you and see who you are and where you're from. Okay, got some folks right here on the back row. Is this, do you know Bob Wallace? Are you Grover? You're Grover, all right. I know who you are. Bob. You want to introduce him? Don't stand up at all. Just stay right there. This guy up here is going to do the talking. The
gentleman there is Grover, and his daughter is Emily.
Emily?
And her friend, Kenny.
Kenny, great, great. Good to have you folks from Columbus here. Glad you're here this morning. Thanks for making it. I appreciate that. And Chad was here Wednesday night, and Chad has his girlfriend with him, I believe. This is Cheryl, if I remember right. And good to have Cheryl with us today. That's great. I had a good visit with Chad yesterday, just for a few minutes. Great to have you this morning. Thank you. All right. Anyone else today? Okay. If you'll be kind enough to take just a moment and fill the card out for us that the usher handed to you, we appreciate you doing that. A little bit, we have the offering. Just drop that card in the plate, if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming today. We're glad you're here. Let's give our guests a warm welcome, shall we?
From a royal throne to grief and shame.
231. Would you turn with me, please? 231. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go. Follow, follow on. 231. Let's sing that first all together. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere he leads me, I would follow, follow on, walking in his footsteps till the crown be won. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Everywhere he lead me, I will follow on. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the storms are sweeping and the dark waters flow. With his hand to lead me, I will never, never fear. Danger cannot fright me if my Lord is near. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere he lead me, I will follow on. Children, you can be dismissed to junior church as we sing this last together. Children, you are dismissed. Down in the valley or upon the mountain steep, close beside my Savior would my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that he has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Everywhere he leads me, I will follow on. Amen. That's great singing this morning. Let's turn over to 144, if you would. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright. Let's stand together as we sing 144. All together on that first verse. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Let's sing that last together, Silent Night, Holy Night, Wondrous Star, lend thy light. Did you find your seats? We'll sing that all together. Silent Night, Holy Night, Wondrous Star, lend thy light, with the angels let us sing Alleluia to our King. Christ the Savior is born, Christ the Savior born. Let's sing that first verse one more time. We're going to sing that a cappella. All right? Let's sing that Silent Night, Holy Night, all is calm, all is bright. All together. Silent Night, Holy Night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
Great singing. You may be seated. Good job this morning. Ushers will come and receive our offering today. Give as God has blessed and prospered you. And next Sunday will be our special Christmas offering that it will take for the electric piano for downstairs and some materials for the missionaries in Honduras and some of the things that they could use there. So be prepared for that next Lord's Day. All right. Let's pray and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. Brother Danny, right?
Let's pray. Father, we love you, and we thank you for the love that you have shown to us. Thank you for the price that you paid for our forgiveness. Allow our lives to be an ongoing expression of gratitude, for you are the one whose worth is beyond measure. Father, help us to see people the way you see them. Not important because of what they can do or how they look, but because they are created in your image, Father. And you loved them enough to die for them. You are to be celebrated above all others. You have been highly exalted and given a name above all names. And one day, Lord, every knee will bow. And every tongue will confess that you are Lord. We thank you for your faithfulness throughout the years. And we pray that you would help us finish strong in service to you. Please go up and down every aisle and stop at every occupied seat. Speak to us today, Father. We need to hear from you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Sally. That's great. Turn to the book of Ruth this morning, if you would please. The book of Ruth, chapter 1. Joshua judges Ruth. If you hit Samuel, stop and come back. Okay? Ruth, chapter 1. We're going to begin reading with verse number 8, and we'll read through verse number 18. And we read the verses responsibly. We begin together on verse 8, then I read verse 9, together on 10, and we alternate like that until we end together on verse 18 of Ruth chapter 1. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 8 of Ruth chapter 1. Ready? And Naomi said unto her two daughters-in-law, go, return each to her mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you, as ye have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant you that ye may find rest, each of you in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voice and wept. And they said unto her, surely we will return with thee unto thy people. And Naomi said, turn again, my daughters. Why will ye go with me? Are there yet any more sons in my womb, that they may be your husbands? Turn again, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say, I have hope, if I should have an husband also tonight, and should also bear sons, would ye tarry for them till they were grown? Would ye stay for them from having husbands? Nay, my daughters, for it grieveth me much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord is gone out against me. And they lifted up their voice and wept again, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. And she said, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee, or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. When she saw that she was steadfastly minded to go with her, then she left speaking unto her. And let's pray together. Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this morning. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to make our hearts ready to receive the truth from your word this morning. Thank you already for what we've heard, for the wonderful music we've enjoyed. And Lord, I pray that you'll continue now to bless this special that'll be sung, that it'll continue to make our hearts good ground that the Word of God can fall into and bring forth fruit. Lord, help us to put our heart in tune with your heart this morning, that we'll have ears to hear what you would want to say to each of us today. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the darkness of a winter's eve, baby Jesus came to earth. In the stillness, hear creation sing of the little baby's birth. Born in a manger long ago, how could the Savior love me so? He left his throne for Calvary. He came to earth for me. Not a palace for the little king, not a pillow for his head, not a scepter for his royal hand, nor a crown adorns his head. Born in a manger long ago, could the Savior love me so? He left his throne for Calvary. He came to earth for me. I have nothing fit to give a king, but I long to do my part. All I treasure, I will gladly bring, for I give him all my heart. Born in a manger long ago, how could the Savior love me so? He left his throne for Calvary. He came to earth for me.
Father in heaven, we bow before you now in prayer as we come to the preaching of your word. Lord, I want to thank you this morning for the Bible, for the wonderful privilege we have to have your words in our hands this morning. And Father, we ask you to speak to us through your word today. Lord, I believe that the word of God is quick and it's powerful and it's sharper than a two-edged sword. And I pray that you would use it in each one of our lives today to accomplish your will. So please help each of us to give our careful attention to the truths this morning. May you use it, please, in each one of our lives. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The book of Ruth is a great little book in the Old Testament. And it's really a love story. And I was thinking about this when I saw the poll labels are celebrating 46 years together. There was a couple been married for 50 years, and they were sitting reflecting one day, and the wife looked at her brother John, and we looked at her husband and said, things really changed over the years. And he said, well, how's that? She said, you used to sit real close to me. He said, well, I can fix that. And so he got up and moved real close to his wife. Then she said, well, you used to hold me real tight. So he wrapped his arms around her and held her real tight. And then she said, you used to nuzzle my neck and nibble my earlobe. And with that, he got up and ran out of the room. He was gone for a few minutes, and she finally looked at him, and he came back in the room, and she goes, what happened? He said, I had to go get my teeth. Now, that wasn't them. That was just somebody else, but we're going to look at love this morning, not at romantic love like that, but the love of friendship. And, you know, it's the love between a mother, believe it or not, a mother and her daughter-in-law. And a love between Ruth and Naomi. You know, Naomi and her family, her husband, her two sons had left Bethlehem during a hard time, time of famine. And they journeyed down to a place called Moab. It's not where they belonged. It's not a place they should have gone. Bethlehem, anybody knows what Bethlehem means? House of bread. House of bread. And they went down to Moab to try to seek. Maybe they heard they were hiring down there. Maybe they heard there's good work to be had down there. Maybe they heard the economy is doing better down there, but for whatever reason it is, they left. And the Bible says they just went to sojourn. In other words, they didn't intend to stay very long. In other words, we're just going to stay for a little time and until this kind of blows over, and then we're coming back home. But you find out a few months turned into a few years, and a few years turned into over a decade. And while they're down there, the two sons end up marrying two girls who were from Moab. And Elimelech, over this period of time, their dad dies, Naomi's husband. And then in the process of time, the Bible doesn't give us details. It only says her two sons died as well. The husband of Ruth and Orpah, okay? It's not Oprah. Okay, it's Orpah. And they died. And Naomi has become pretty bitter. She gets a very pessimistic view of life. She's lost, gone away from home, went down to a strange land, lost her husband, lost both of her sons. And now she's in a land with two daughters-in-law that are from there, but she's not from there. And she finally decides, I'm going to go back home. And when she decides to go home, she tells Orpah and Ruth, you stay here. I mean, I got nothing for you. I'm going to go back to my folks, and I think Naomi thinks I'm just going to go back home and die. And there's no future for you with me. Stay here. There'll be somebody who you'll be able to find and marry and have a happy life. In fact, you're familiar with these surroundings. You're familiar with your gods. They were not the God of Israel. It was not the God that Naomi had grown up worshiping and serving. Well, the one daughter-in-law, Orpah, kissed her goodbye and headed back to wherever she wanted to go with the people she knew in Moab. But Ruth didn't leave. Ruth decides she's going to stay. And if you look in Ruth chapter 1 again, Naomi says to her in verse 15, your sister-in-law has gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. Come on, go with her. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. And thy people shall be my people, and here's a big phrase, and thy God, my God. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. And then verse 18 says, when Naomi saw how steadfast Ruth was about it, she didn't even bring it up to her again. That's love in action. And I want to talk about love in action for a little bit this morning. Love is not just a feeling. I don't want to discount that there aren't any feelings in love, but the world completely says love is just a feeling. And so I fall in love and I fall out of love. But that's not the way the Bible describes love. Love is action. God so loved the world, He gave. God didn't so love the world, He got warm fuzzies for us. Okay? It doesn't mean God doesn't have warm feelings for us. But that's not love. It's okay to have feelings, but the truth is, love is action. Love is doing what's best for the other person. Love is fulfilling the needs of somebody else. Love is, in Reformers Unanimous, it's the willing, sacrificial giving of oneself for the benefit of someone else, for the benefit of others, with no thought of return. I'm not thinking, okay, I'll do this so they'll do this for me. No, that's not love. Then I'm thinking of what I can get out of it. It says, I'm willingly, sacrificially giving for the needs of somebody else without any thought of remuneration or getting anything in return. That's love. So God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. You know why? That's what we needed. That's what we needed. So God willingly, sacrificially gave to what we needed. That's love. You're going to see, I want to talk to you about, you know, Christmas time is a time that we ought to show others the love of Christ. For the Christian, it's Christmas time 365 days a year. Not just a certain time of the year, not just for a certain few weeks or a day of the year. We are to show the love of Christ as a way of life. And I want to just talk about some practical things I see here in Ruth and her relationship with Naomi to show that how we can show our love to others. in some practical ways, all right? Let me give you five practical ways to show your love to others. Number one is this. You show love to others by sticking with them through tough times. Sticking with them through tough times. Ruth was saying, wherever you go, I'm going. Wherever you live, that's where I'll live. Your people are going to be my people. Your friends are going to be my friends. Your God is my God. I'm going to be with you no matter what. No matter what happened. No matter what goes on. No matter what life brings at you. I'm going to be your friend. And by the way, that's friendship. Friendship is not you. Friendship is simply you deciding to be someone's friend. I can be your friend whether you want to be my friend or not. I can still be your friend. And I'm going to do my best to be friendly and to show myself friendly and to stick with you no matter what. That's friendship. That's love. Ruth would stay by Naomi's side. I think this is illustrated as I was thinking about in the Bible how this could be a good illustration of this. And you know what I thought of? I thought of Abraham and Lot. You remember that Lot had been with Abraham and Lot had gotten pretty wealthy being with Abraham. Until one day the herdmen of Lot and the herdmen of Abraham were arguing with each other, kind of having a fight with each other over land and over water. And of course, the word came to Abraham and Abraham came to Lot and he said, we're not going to have any of this. We're brethren. And so he said, all right, you want to separate and go your way? You choose whatever way you want to go. Whatever way you go, I'll go the other way. And he gave Lot that choice. Now, we know Lot made the wrong choice, didn't he? And he started towards Sodom, and he didn't just start towards Sodom. He ended up living in Sodom. And Sodom was an exceeding wicked city before the Lord. And listen, wasn't there in Sodom very long until Sodom got attacked by five different kings. You remember the story? And they took some people away captive. Who did they take away captive? Lot. Abraham hears about it. Abraham said, serves him right. No, he didn't say that. Well, I knew when he made that choice, I knew what kind of trouble he'd get into. I mean, I'm telling you, I knew that was going to happen. No, that's what independent Baptists say. That's not what Abraham said. Okay? You know what Abraham said? He said, fellas, we're going to go get him back. And he got his trained servants, and he took off after him. And he went out, and he recovered Lot and all the ones that were captured, and he brought them back to Sodom. And so much so, the king of Sodom wanted to give them all sorts of remuneration for it, and Abraham wouldn't take anything. And by the way, he didn't bring Lot back and say, now have you learned your lesson? Huh? Now you're going to be ready to get out of this hellhole and come live with me? He didn't say that. He put him right back where he was and left him. Went back to his business. I don't know about you, but that's love. That's love. Don't think, listen, sometimes people misunderstand something. They think that because you love somebody who's doing wrong, that you're condoning their wrong. But you're not condoning their wrong. You're simply loving them at all times. The Bible says a friend loveth at all times. I'm not going to say who it is. There was a teenager that was wayward here. And out of the clear blue a few months ago, my phone rang on a Sunday afternoon, and it was that teenager. He just had a question about the Bible. He had been talking to somebody, and he just wanted to make sure that he was telling them the right thing. And he called the pastor. And you know what? I'm glad he could call the pastor. Because he doesn't have to. He knows the pastor doesn't agree with what he's doing. But he knows the pastor loves him and would talk to him. That's love. The Bible says a friend loveth at all times. All times. I think of David and Jonathan. Think about Peter with Jesus. Jesus to Peter. A friend loves at all times. we all know the verse, Proverbs 18:24, the man that hath friends must show himself friendly. Do you know the last part of that verse? I'm sorry, I couldn't quite hear that. Yeah. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Huh? Isn't that a good word, sticketh? Huh? There's a friend that sticks closer. That's what a friend does. He sticks with you. You can't shake him loose. Thank God if you have a friend like that. Ask God to make you a friend like that. Show your love by sticking with someone through tough times. Number two, you show your love by adjusting to others. Ruth said, your people are going to be my people, and your God will be my God. You know, life is adjusting. I remember the adjustments that come. Yeah, I remember the adjustments that come when you get married. I'll never forget, Brother Dave, we weren't married very long. And I was doing something out in the garage or something, and I needed to go to the store to get something. So I got in the car, took off, went to the store, got what I needed, came back home, and guess who is waiting for me? Mrs. Slabaugh said, where you been? What do you mean where I've been? I had to go get something. She goes, well, you're supposed to tell me when you're leaving like that. Really? Huh? That was new to me. I had to make an adjustment real quick, all right? Or my back would need adjustment from the couch. But there are adjustments that take place, isn't there? And you go in to get the toothpaste and it's all mangled. How many of you are married to somebody? How many of you are married to a mangler? Anybody married to a mangler? They just grab toothpaste anywhere they want and squeeze it. You like that? Yeah. How many of that bothers you? Does that bother you at all? How many like to squeeze it right on up, make it nice, and keep it? Thank you. I don't care. You're going to get preaching while you're here. I don't care who you are. Okay? Changes come. Changes come in your life, and adjustments come when you start having children. All of a sudden, you know, when we laugh sometimes when couples with two or three children say, okay, we'll be there at, 7:30. We kind of smile at each other thinking, well, they may make it by 8. But you understand, you don't just go out and get in the car and go. Especially in these days with all the car seats and all the contraptions and all the way you got to buckle them in and all this stuff. It's a procedure to just get them out and get them in the car and get them back out of the car. Well, I'm glad I grew up in a day when they just threw us in the car, amen? Huh? Remember that? Your seatbelt, remember that? Your seatbelt was your mom or dad putting her arm out. That's it. And we made it. How about that? Adjustments. One little girl said, Mommy, where are the jerks? She said, what? She said, well, every time Daddy drives, he says there are a lot of jerks out there. You learn to start adjusting how you talk when your children start repeating what you say. Some of you are making the adjustment to being a Christian at Christmas. And now you find out that Christ is at the center. Not all the things the world would put at the center. You're going to find out the Christmas story isn't sitting down and reading the night before Christmas. The Christmas story is sitting down and reading Luke chapter 2 with your family and talking about the birth of Jesus. You're going to find that Christmas Day is getting up and saying, hey, it's Sunday. Let's go to church on Christmas Day. Let's be in the house of God on Christmas Day. You see, adjusting. That's what love does. When you love the Lord Jesus, then changes take place in your life, and you begin to make adjustments, and you begin to do what he desires you to do. It changes the focus of Christmas. So love is always willing to adjust to others. I'm not sure when. I'm positive that my wife has adjusted more than I have in our marriage. And You know, one of the great things he's just to, I grew up in a very, very sports-minded family and a very competitive family. And she has adjusted through the years to where she's become a sports fan. And she watches the games with me. And she's learning some things, all right? It's an enjoyable time. But those are adjustments that you make. And you always have to be willing to make the adjustments. That's love. Love is sticking with people through tough times. Love is adjusting. Love is reaching beyond your comfort zone. Love is reaching beyond your comfort zone. You know what she said in verse 17? She said, where you die, I will die. And there will I be buried. When I read that, I thought about the vows you make when you get married. Till death do us part. To death do us part. I promise to stay with you for better, for worse, rich or poor, sickness and death, sickness and health, until death do us part. And what I think it's saying, listen, when it says sickness and health are richer or poorer, better for worse, what he's saying is, I'm sticking with you beyond my comfort zone. I'm going to stick with you even when it's not comfortable for me. I'm going to stay with you. Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, you have to deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow me. You find out that if you're going to follow Jesus Christ and be what the Lord wants you to be, you find out pretty quickly that that's not going to be a comfortable thing. It'll take you out of your comfort zone. It begins to stretch you in areas that sometimes you're not real comfortable with. But you know what I found out? I found out that when you start doing something that's not comfortable and you continue to do it, pretty soon it will become comfortable. For some of you, just getting up and coming to church on Sunday morning, that was a bit uncomfortable because that's not something you're used to. But I assure you, if you will continue to do it, it will become comfortable. And for some of you, when we talk about coming back on Sunday night, that's real uncomfortable. But I assure you that if you'll do that, it will become comfortable. And it will become something you enjoy. And then, by the way, God doesn't leave you there. He'll begin to stretch you some more. Continue to ask you to deny yourself. You cannot serve God and self. You can't do that. If he's the Lord, then you have to do what he wants you to do. And that means you have to go beyond your comfort zone. Let me give you number four. You show love by offering encouraging words. Ruth said to her in verse 16, Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee. Says Naomi, please don't discourage me from coming with you. Naomi, don't tell me not to do this. Don't tell me what I can't do or what I shouldn't do. I wanna be with you. I wanna be wherever you go. I want you to know, Naomi, wherever you go, whatever you do, whatever happens, you are going to have somebody at your side, and that's going to be me. Wow. How encouraging would that be? I read this past week in the periodical about two seminary students in New Orleans years ago. They stopped at a local grocery store, and one of the students was a fellow named Don Wilton. And in the store, there was a kind of, rough-looking couple. Not rough, tough-wise, just not very well-dressed in anything, and they had a baby that only had a diaper on. And God's Spirit moved in those students' hearts. And they decided that they would open their wallets and give this couple all the money they had. Don rolled up the bills they had. It was almost $200. He went up behind the man who was barefoot, and he stuck that roll of bills in his back. And he told him not to turn around. And with a gentle voice, he said, my friend, you don't know who I am. He said, but I want you to know there's another man in here tonight with me, and we love the Lord Jesus. He's done something for us that we can't do for ourselves, and because of him, we want to give you something from the two of us. And he put that money in the man's pocket. They left the store that night, and Don Wilton thought he'd never see him again. Nearly 12 years went by. Now, Dr. Don Wilton was teaching at the seminary. One of the new students recognized his distinctive South African voice. It was the young man from that convenience store that night. He told Dr. Wilton they were desperate that night, so desperate they had driven from their home in Alabama to commit suicide by jumping off a bridge in New Orleans. They planned to take their baby with them, but they decided to feed her first so that at least she'd die on a full stomach. And that's why they stopped at the store. But they were so encouraged by the kindness and the kind words of the two men they met that wouldn't let him see his face, they changed their minds. That act of kindness had set that man on a path to salvation and a call to the ministry, where he was now training in seminary. You know, you may have heard it said, there are basement people or there's balcony people. What I mean by that is basement people are the discouragers in our life. People from the past, the present, but their words go everywhere we go. Negative influences in our lives. I mean, people who say, you can't do that. Or that was a stupid thing to do. Why'd you do that? Are you ever going to do anything right? Or you're never going to amount to anything. Basement people that like to crush your dreams and your hopes. They constantly point out what's wrong rather than what's right. Basement people cause the room to brighten up whenever they leave. Now the contrast to that is the balcony people. Those are the people who are there to cheer us on, to give us love and encouragement. They are in the cheering section. They're the ones saying, you can do this. I'm praying for you. They're the ones who will say, you're special to God. God's got plans for your life. They're the ones who will give you the encouragement. And everybody needs encouragement. Everybody needs some balcony people in their life. The question is not how do you have in your life, but the question is, what will you be? Will you be a balcony person or will you be a basement person? Mom and Dad, listen carefully this morning. What are you to your children? Are you the basement person or are you the balcony person? I believe there's no question what God would have us to be. I know God would have us to be the balcony. Encouraging others to serve him and live for him. Words of encouragement are so necessary. And they're so necessary for us to speak them to people. It can change somebody's life forever. Then let me say number five. The fifth way you show practical love to somebody is by putting their needs above your needs. When Naomi saw that she was steadfastly minded to go, Ruth wasn't going to change her mind, she quit talking to her. And it wasn't quit talking to her completely, but she quit talking to her about that matter. Nothing was going to stop her from going. Ruth was determined to stick with Naomi. And by the way, even though the friendship at this point And you find as it goes forward, it's pretty much one-sided. It's Ruth being a friend of Naomi. When Naomi, you find out, when Naomi gets back home to Bethlehem, people don't recognize her, number one. She's aged a lot in the years that she's been gone. People said, is this Naomi? And she said, don't call me Naomi, which means pleasant. She said, call me Mara, which means what? Bitter. She said, I went out full, but the Lord has brought me home empty. Well, wait a minute. Remember why she went to Moab in the first place? Thought they were hungry. Thought they were empty. She came to realize I really was full. But she says, I came back empty. She said, I come back with nothing. Now, wait a minute. When she's telling these people, I came back with nothing, who's standing beside her? What do you think Ruth thought? What am I, chopped liver? Well, if that's the way you're going to be. No. See, she wasn't a friend because Naomi was a friend to her. She said, I'm going to be a friend because I said I'll be your friend. Wherever you go, I'll go. Whatever you live, that's where I'm going to live. I'm sticking with you. I don't understand. People say, I'm not going to be your friend because what she said to me. If that's how weak, you never were her friend. You never were. A friend loveth at all times. Well, Pastor, you don't know what she said. A friend loveth at all times. Friend will show their love by putting their needs above your own needs. You know, the book of Ruth, at the end of the book of Ruth, Ruth ends up, it's a great story. If you're not familiar with it, you ought to read through it. Meets a fellow there, God has for her, named Boaz, and it's a great romantic story. They end up getting married. It's a real Hallmark movie right there, man. And they end up getting married, and there's a genealogy at the end of the book. And these genealogies, there's dozens of them throughout the Bible that you'll find, and they're really family trees, so to speak, of God's promises to his people. And this is God's promise. He told Abraham in Genesis 12 that all families of the earth would be blessed through him. And he grafted in a couple Gentiles like Rahab and Ruth in there to bring David into the world. Obed begat Jesse. Jesse begat David. Boaz and Ruth end up in the lineage of Jesus Christ, the Messiah. The one that God's going to send because he loves us. The one that God has sent into the world to show that he loves you and me. The one that's going to stick closer to us than a brother, Jesus Christ. Think about that. Does Jesus stick with you through the tough times? Sure does. Does he accept you as you are? Yes, he does. Does he reach beyond his comfort zone for us? Yes, he did. Does he offer us words of encouragement and hope? Yes, he does. Does he put our needs ahead of his needs? Yes, he does. He did that when he went to the cross. But what we needed more than what he needed. And through Christ, we have salvation. Through Christ, we have eternal life. My friend, if you'd ever realized that God loved you enough to send his only begotten Son, and he died on the cross for your sin, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. He died for you. He died in your place. Died in my place. And as many as receive him, to them, God gives the power to become the children of God. The sons of God, even to them who believe on his name. Believe on Jesus, you can be saved. So I guess I just want to encourage you to show love to somebody this Christmas. Be aware of somebody else. Don't turn your focus inward. Turn it outward. Say, who can I show love to this Christmas time? Don't overlook the people you live with. They need love too. A lot of times you hear a message and you say, okay, I got to go find this person or think of this person, and we completely overlook the ones we're with all the time. They need love too. I don't know if you ever heard the story of the red marbles or not, but this man writes, I was in the South at the corner grocery store buying potatoes, and a small boy, ragged but clean, hungrily appraising a basket of freshly picked green peas. He said, I paid for my potatoes, but was drawn to the display of fresh green peas. He says, I'm kind of a pushover for cream peas and new potatoes. Pondering the peas, I overheard the conversation between Mr. Miller, who owned the store, and the ragged boy who was looking at the peas. Hello, Barry, how are you? Hello, Mr. Miller, fine, thank you. Them peas sure look good. They are good, Barry. How's your ma? Oh, she's fine, getting stronger all the time. Can anything I help you with? No, sir, just admiring them peas. Well, would you like to take some home? Asked Mr. Miller. No, sir, got nothing to pay for them with. Well, what do you got to trade me for them peas? Well, all I got's my prize marble here. Is that right? Let me see it. Here it is. She's a dandy. Oh, Mr. Miller said, I can see that. Only thing is, Barry, this one's blue, and I sort of go for red. Do you got a red one like this at home? Well, not exactly, but almost. I tell you what, Barry, you take this sack of peas home with you, and next trip you come this way, you let me look at that red marble. Sure will. Thanks, Mr. Miller. Mrs. Miller, who'd been standing nearby, came over to help me. With a smile, she said, there's two other boys just like him in our town. All three are very poor, in very poor circumstances. Jim just loves to bargain with them for peas and apples and tomatoes or whatever. And when they come back with their red marbles, and they always do, he decides he doesn't really like red after all. And he sends them home with a bag of produce for a green or an orange one when they come back on their next trip to the store. I left that store smiling to myself, impressed with this man. He said, a short time later, I moved out to Colorado, but I never forgot the story of that man and the boys and the bartering for marbles. Years went by, until he said, I had occasion to visit some old friends in my hometown. And when I was there, I learned Mr. Miller died, and they were having his visitation that evening. Knowing my friends wanted to go, I agreed to go with them. And upon arriving at the funeral home, we got in line to meet the relatives and to offer whatever words of comfort we could. And ahead of us in line were three young men. One was in an army uniform, and the other two had nice haircuts, dark suits, white shirts, all very professional looking. They approached Mrs. Miller, and she was standing, smiling by her husband's casket. Each of the young men hugged her, kissed her on the cheek, and spoke briefly with her, and then moved on to the casket. Her misty light blue eyes followed them as one by one they each stopped briefly and placed his own warm hand over the cold, pale hand in the casket. And each walked out of the funeral home, wiping the tears from their eyes. Our turn came to meet Mrs. Miller, and I told her who I was, and I reminded her of the story those many years ago about her husband bartering for marbles. With her eyes glistening, she said she took me by the hand and took me to the casket. Those three young men who just left were the boys I told you about. They just told me how they appreciated the things Jim traded them. Now at last, when Jim couldn't change his mind about the color or the size, they came to pay their debt. We never had a great deal of wealth in this world, she confided, but right now Jim would consider himself to be the richest man in the world. With loving gentleness, she lifted the lifeless fingers of her deceased husband, and resting underneath were three exquisitely shined red marbles. And the moral is simply this, folks. You're not going to be remembered just by your words. You're going to remember by your deeds. You're going to remember by your actions. Love somebody. Show your love to somebody. If you've never accepted God's gift to you of eternal life through Jesus Christ, accept Him today as your Savior. Let's pray. Father, we bow before You in prayer this morning. Thank You. Thank You for this wonderful story in the book of Ruth. The strong friendship, the strong love that Ruth showed to Naomi. And You rewarded her richly for that. Lord, would You help us to know that when we love others, we'll never come out on the losing end. God, thank You for loving us. May we be conduits of Your love to other people. May we allow Your love to flow through us to others. May You help us in practical ways to show our love to others during this season and really all year long. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a moment and we'll have our invitation. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I wonder how many folks in the room today would say, Pastor, there's a time in my life when I understood that I was a sinner. And I understood that as a sinner, I needed to pay for my sin in hell. That's what I deserved. But I believed Jesus, and I heard that Jesus came and He died on the cross and He paid my penalty for sin. He suffered my hell for me. He paid the price that I deserved to pay. That if I would trust what He's done for me and put my faith in Him, He would give me the gift of eternal life and one day take me to heaven. And I wonder here this morning when say, Pastor, there's a day that I called on Jesus and from my heart I trusted Him as my Savior. And I accepted His gift of eternal life. And Pastor, I know this morning that if anything happened to me, I know that I'd go to heaven. Pastor, I know Jesus is my Savior. Would you slip your hand up as a testimony to that and say, Pastor, that's my case this morning. I know that I'm a Christian. I know that I'm saved. Okay, you may put it down. You here this morning would say, Pastor, I don't know that for sure. But I'd like to. Oh, my friend, if you don't have the assurance that when you take your last breath here, your next breath will be in heaven, I guarantee you want that assurance. You would like to have that. And the great news is, you can have that. And if you're here this morning and say, Pastor, I don't know for sure if I died I'd go to heaven. I don't know for sure about what you've been talking about, but Pastor, would you pray for me this morning? And I'd be delighted to just pray for you. I'll not embarrass you. We'll not call you out. But I'll remember you in prayer. Would you slip your hand up and say, Pastor, pray for me this morning. I'm not sure about my eternal destiny. God bless you. Thank you. Is there somebody else who would join these? Say, Pastor, pray for me this morning. The message was mainly to believers today. I wonder how many believers would say, Preacher, God spoke to my heart today about showing love to others and ways I can show love to others. And the Spirit of God dealt with my heart today. And I want God to love others through me. And I want to do that in some of the practical ways you mentioned this morning. How many would you say, Pastor, God spoke to my heart today. Please pray for me. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Yes. Amen. That's good. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray, and then we'll have our invitation. When I'm done praying, we'll stand to our feet. The pianist will play. Brother Bob will sing an invitation hymn. If you're here today and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you do not know if you died you'd go to heaven. As soon as we stand to sing and the piano begins to play, would you slip from your seat? Others will be coming to pray. Meet me here at the front. We have folks who have been trained. They'll take a Bible and they'll show you how you can know Christ as your Savior. Oh, walk out the door in a few minutes. knowing you have eternal life. Walk out the door in a few minutes knowing that your sins are forgiven. Don't spend another day without having that settled. If you're here today and you're saved and you've never been scripturally baptized, or if you're saved and you're baptized and you believe this is where you ought to belong, whatever God has dealt with your heart about, Christian, you just want to come and bow the knee and say, God, use me to love others in practical ways. Help me not to worry about having friends. Help me to be a friend to somebody. Just obey what the Lord's telling you to do this morning. Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts today. Thank you for decisions that have already been made in people's hearts, and I pray you'd seal those decisions this morning at an altar. As we bow our knee to you, Lord, I pray that every individual here would do exactly what your Holy Spirit's prompting them to do. Oh, may they listen. May they always say yes to you. And may your will be done in every heart in these next few minutes. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this morning, will you? That's right.
Be seated, if you would, please.
Glad to have Alan Walters coming this morning. Alan, we met at the CRC. We were in there with, he came to the RU program and has been coming on Friday nights to that. And Alan came to me this morning and he said, you know, last Sunday he talked to Brother Danny over here and said always bothered him. He made a profession of faith when he was younger, but he just always that nagging doubt inside that he was really saved. And if the Lord came back, whether he would go or not. And he said, I just had to get it settled. And so last Sunday he said he settled it. And he's trusting Jesus Christ as his Savior from this day forward. So he's going to follow the Lord in believer's baptism this morning. And that's great, Alan. Amen? That's great. That's, salvation's not something you want to guess about or hope about. You want to know. Amen? And that's a good decision this morning, all right? We'll prepare to get Alan baptized. And Brother Bob will lead you in a song or some. And then we'll be ready to baptize this morning.
Well, let's do a few favorites. Maybe a song that we don't sing very often, and you enjoy something that we know maybe, if you could. But anybody have a favorite they'd like? I know, spring it up on you. Jan? Number 20. I'm standing on the solid rock. Through my disappointment, strife, and discontentment, I cast my every care on the Lord. Let's sing that first together. Through my disappointment, strife, and discontentment, I cast my every care on the Lord. No matter what obsession, pain, or deep depression, I'm standing on the solid rock. I'm standing on the rock of ages. Come on. But not from Satan's wages. I'm standing on the solid rock. Let's sing that last. Now I'm pressing onward. Each step leads me homeward. I'm trusting in my Savior day by day. And close to our relation. I'm standing on the rock of ages, safe from all the storms that rages, rich, but not from Satan's wages. I'm standing on the solid rock. Amen. Elijah? 57. 57. Years I spent at Calvary, spent in vanity and pride at Calvary. 57. All in that verse together. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Amen. Sarah? 275. It is well. It is well with my soul, I believe, is what that is. 275. Let's sing that first together. How about not another one? Maybe afterwards.
is Alan Walters. And Alan, upon the public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of Jesus' death, raised in the likeness of his death.
Amen!
And the servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen.
All right. Brother Abrams? 149. I'm thinking that's, he lives. 149. God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Andy? 137. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let's stand as we sing this, all right? Joy to the world. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. Let's sing that last. Here rules the world. The glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love and wonders, wonders of his love. I'm not exactly sure, but that may be Drew's favorite Christmas carol. He's been sure enjoying practicing with the choir. It's amazing. I wish y'all could see him practice with everybody else. I'm having a hard time figuring out if I should have a booster seat up here for him. He does a great job, Pastor.
All right. Remember, what time tonight? 5:45 to start. Those of you with parents with children, whatever time you have, that's when you be here. And be ready to go. We'll have a great time this evening. Thanks for being here this morning. Let's have prayer together. Father, we thank you for a wonderful Lord's Day today. Thank you, Lord, for each one that was able to make their way to church this morning. Pray your blessing now upon us as we leave this place today. Give us a good afternoon. Prepare our hearts what you have for us tonight. Pray you'll be with the children and help them to do their very best this evening. Come back and meet with us again this evening, Lord, and give us what we need on this Lord's Day. We prayed in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. for I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.